Praise the Lord. I appreciate the Lord one more time for this time in His presence. Give Him praise from the depth of your heart. There's a place where worship becomes worship indeed. Where the utterances of our lips are not a function of human intelligence. The utterances of our lips becomes an effulgence of the life of God that is locked up in the boundaries of our hearts. There's a place where worship becomes a statement of absolute committal to the will of the Father. Where the lives of men are spent that the glory of Him that dwells in the chambers of Zion may litter the landscape, and everyone that has breath upon his nostril may bow in worship, in reverence, and in adoration. There's a place where worship becomes a connection between the earthly and the immortal regions of Zion. Because there are functionaries and entities on the earth that have decided to make their lives a gangway to the spirit. Can you lift your voice to heaven this morning and cry to the God of heaven? Let it be a statement of life, so that the will of the Father can find expression through us. There's a place where worship goes beyond singing. The Bible said that 20 and 4 elders, they fall to the ground and they casted their crowns. Everything that gave them stature and ranking in the spirit, they submitted it to the one that sat upon the throne. There's a place where worship becomes a commitment of life eternally to the will of the Father. Jesus was in Gethsemane and he said, "Lord, not my will, but thine." It is the loudest statement of worship that was made in all eternity. At that point in Gethsemane, where the Son of God himself submitted his will for the will of the Father to find expression. And we worship the Lord this morning. Severina paparia savida grahanda ragados, sediso grahatidas, rapairia lindra capaza lura hakatinas. Sometimes the reason we speak in tongues is because there is not enough vocabulary to give expression to the buttons in our heart. We want to speak, but we lack words. We lack words to give ventilation to that which is happening in our spirit. So we release it in tongues. Mariana Tatas, Parika Parina Sabana, Arianda Paraganas, Oruata, Epere Haliko, Asevina Karianda Dia, Omuleka, Aparara Sapaniata. There we travel in the spirit. We come to a place where even tongues are no longer enough. That's when we begin to grow in the spirit. Even the tongues are no longer enough, because what is coming out of us is the substance of life. So we need the help of the Holy Ghost himself to help us to give expression to that which flows from our bowels. That's why he said, "The Spirit helpeth. The Spirit helpeth our infirmities." There is something we want to communicate to I am that I am, but we don't have words. So the Spirit himself have to speak on our behalf. Then we go further. Then we begin to chant in the Holy Ghost. We chant in the Holy Ghost. This time, we have journeyed beyond articulate speech. It's no longer about what we know. Life wants to flow like a river. It flows like a river. Ayatanas, Pararata, Eita, Hatia, Sura. Hallelujah.
Spirit. Hear the utterance of spirit. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Listen. Always learn to stir yourself in the spirit. Apart from the fact that it's when incense are released from your spirit that you can produce pure worship, it also takes you to heights in Zion where you can make contact with hallowed realities. There are many things about your destiny you will never know because they are locked up in heights in the spirit. Many never travel enough to hear the instructions of their destiny. They have a witness that they are prophets. They have a witness, but they never travel to where the prophetic mantle is received because they don't stare enough. I want to teach you this morning. Every time you go higher, you begin to collide with things. As we were going higher, I received the breaking news. And the Lord told me somebody received an encounter yesterday about his destiny. The Lord visited somebody and told the person what he will have the person do expressly for the first time. I just heard it because we were going higher. Your antennas in the spirit open. Thank you, Lord.
Hallelujah. Amen. You may be seated. God bless you.
I needed to keep it calm this morning because I want to do a teaching. You know, the nature of the conference is such that the Spirit of God has a burden to bring us perspective about what He's doing and about the things that really matter in our engagements in the Spirit. It's obvious the meeting is not necessarily a revival meeting. It's for perspective. When you talk about spiritual alignment, then God wants to show you the things that you should give priority to. Emphasis that constitute priority as touching your walk with the Lord. That's what God is interested in dealing with. Although tonight, we are going to add the revival flame so that some persons will receive empowerment. You know, you are already people of prayer. There's a wind of prayer blowing on your campus. But if you are not taught and you are not given instructions as touching the exactitude of that which the Lord wants to do with you and in this corporate assembly and territory, you may be praying, touching a lot of things in the spirit, but you may not understand how to maximize them and come into conformity with the will of the Father. And that's why teachings like this have become very important. Glory to God. By the help of the Holy Spirit last night, we tried to establish a few things bordering on what alignment really is. And we said it's possible to know a lot of spiritual realities, to be aware of a lot of spiritual realities, but not having the ability to walk in their experiences. It's possible to know and be aware about the truths of healing, but to find yourself sick, not walking in the reality of divine health. It's possible to know about your calling and ordination, that you are a prophet, but not sustaining the capacity to walk in the fullness of the prophetic dimension. Most times, some of the natural abilities and charismas that we have are components of our being that the Holy Ghost is going to be bringing His dimension into to contribute to the workings of our destiny. But we have not really entered into the spiritual experience of those things. But because the natural ability is there, we think those natural abilities constitute to the arsenals that God wants to use to prosecute our calling and ordination. This is what I mean. God may have called you to be a prophetic psalmist, but naturally you discover you have an aptitude for singing and you have an ability to sing well. And then because you can sing with a good voice and people are blessed, you think that you are already walking in the reality of a prophetic psalmist. Meanwhile, consistent with the handwriting of your ordination, It's not just for you to sing and people are excited or blessed. Because you are a prophetic psalmist, according to the blueprint of your ordination, every time you sing, maybe what God wants to achieve through your voice is to activate spiritual gifts. Now that you have a good voice, we never bring you to a point where your singing can activate spiritual gifts unless the supernatural dimension is superimposed on it. But if you don't understand this, you may be aware that you are a prophetic psalmist. And because you have a good voice, you may think that you are already fulfilling your calling. But in heaven, your call begins to register in the radar of Zion the day that what God destined you to do begins to find expression. And heaven will begin to score you that you sing and people come into the fullness of their calling. So a prophet can walk into your meeting. An anointed healer can walk into your meeting. But he's not walking in the experience of the healing anointing. But because he sat under you and you sang, the oil is speaking. And then he leaves that meeting. He prays for the sick, they are healed. He will not even know you were the one that activated it. Heaven will register you to be fulfilling destiny the day that dimension of spiritual activation begins to walk through your voice. And you may never realize it because you have a good voice. Are we together? So we said, it's possible to know and be aware that there is a dimension of God that is supposed to find expression in your life, but never sustaining the capacity to walk in it. So we said the protocol of alignment begins when the dimensions of God that are available to us in His promises becomes our everyday experience. And it was from that premise that we began to define what alignment was all about. Glory to God. You notice that when Adam was created, the Bible said in Genesis 1:26, He said, let us make man in our own image, after our likeness. And He said, in the image of Him, He made man, male and female, He made them. And in verse 27, the Bible said, He began to give man authority and dominion on all of them. On the strength of the design of man, man was able to function like God on earth. Man was a physical and a visible expression of who the spiritual and unseen God was. So if you interacted with Adam, it's as good as though you are interacting with God. So Adam was doing things that God did in the spirit without consulting with God. In Genesis chapter 2 verse 19, the Bible said, Adam named all the animals, and he said that was the name thereof. So the name that God, while he created all the animals in his studio in the spirit, gave to them, the moment Adam looked at the animals, he knew that was their name. So he was operating at an intellectual frequency that was only possible in the divine. Adam was walking on earth as if he was a god. The Bible said in Genesis chapter 2, verse, let me check the scripture now very quickly so that I'll make the point I want to make. Hallelujah. Praise the Lord. Hope you are following my point. The Bible said in Genesis chapter 2, I want to show you these scriptures so that you can write them down and then you follow them. Because this morning I don't want to preach extemporaneously. I want to establish foundational truths. In Genesis chapter 2 verse 22 and 23, he said, he took of the rib of the man and he created the woman and brought the woman unto the man. Remember, when the rib of the man was removed, the man was asleep. But the moment Adam woke up in chapter verse 23, he said, and Adam said, this is now the bone of my bone. How was he aware? He said, she is the flesh of my flesh. God never hinted Adam. That was what he wanted to do. And he said, she shall be called woman because she was taken out of the man. When all of these things was happening, Adam was asleep. First, God said, this is woman. Adam woke up and Adam said, this is woman. There was no difference in
cerebral frequency. The man was functioning like a god in the natural. He said, because he was taken out of the man, how was he aware? There was something at work in the man that gave him the capacity to function like God. So he was a visible expression of the invisible God. But when the man fell, the man was not only guilty of sin because he fell. There was a distortion in his spiritual anatomy and physiology. He no longer looked like the God that was created in his image. And he no longer sustained the capacity, whatever intelligence there was, that gave him the ability to connect to the frequency of God and download the wisdom and the dimension of God, was lost. That ability was lost. So the fall of man was not just man becoming guilty and standing the risk of the messianic judgment. The fall of man was also a mutation in his spiritual DNA. So when you receive Jesus and the truth of the gospel is taught to you, and you escape the judgment of God, there is also another dimension of God you need to engage in to bring your spiritual morphology back to become consistent with the dimensions of God. That is where alignment comes in. Doctrine straightens the mind and brings harmony between your thinking faculty and the thinking faculty of God. But alignment brings your soul and your body and your circumstances into conformity with the dimensions of heaven. Notice, the man that was operating at the frequency of God, what happened? When he fell, the Bible said they took fig leaves and covered themselves. And God came for the first time. His choices were different from God for the first time. And God killed an animal and covered them with the skin of the animal. What has happened? His intellectual capacity had dropped. That was the very first time Adam made a choice that was different from the choice of God. He could no longer think at the frequency of God. So God said, instead of fig leaf, what you should have used was animal skin. What will happen to the fig leaf? By evening, it will wither away. He had dropped in intelligence. So Romans 3:26, the Bible said, 23, he said, for all have sinned and falling short of the glory of God. The glory of God is not light. The glory of God is the full expression of the essence of God. So what made God who God was what man carried. And now that man is falling, he has fallen from the essence and the nature of God. So we began to establish yesterday that before Jesus said, I am the light of the world, even though he knew he was, in John chapter 9 verse 5, he said, so long as I am in the world, I am the light of the world. But we said, for Jesus to walk experientially as the light of the world, there was a protocol of alignment that he had to give himself to. Jesus was in Nazareth for 30 years. He did nothing about the blind. What light meant to the blind was for restoration of sight. What light meant to the deaf was to unstop the deafness. What light means to the brokenhearted is for the heart to heal. Jesus was in Nazareth, even though he was the light. It was established in the spirit that he was the light, but he had no capacity to manifest light until he went through the protocol of alignment. And when he came out of the wilderness, the Bible said that it might be written in Matthew 4:16, which was spoken by Isaiah. Because Isaiah spoke it, it was a reality in the spirit. But for Jesus, who is on ground, to walk in the reality of the prophecy, something needed to happen. He said, that which Isaiah prophesied, the land of Zebulun, the land of Naphtali, by the way of the sea beyond Jordan, the Galilee of the Gentile, that people that sat in darkness have seen a great light. Was that the day Jesus was born? No. But that was the day alignment was satisfied. He was in Nazareth with those in darkness. The day alignment was fulfilled, he became light. While he was in Nazareth and he was not called the light, the prophecy was already in the spirit, because Isaiah spoke it 700 years before he was born. But for that dimension to work, there was an alignment quota that needed to be fulfilled. So John, Paul, writing the book of Romans, from Romans chapter 1 to Romans chapter 8,
he told the Gentiles and everybody, the Jews and the Gentiles, what Jesus had done for them. How that sin had been destroyed. How that they had the mind of Christ. How that they had come to a level where they could walk in the realm of God. And in Romans chapter 9 to chapter 11, he wrote particularly to the Jews and told them how that the promise of the Messiah was fulfilled in Christ. And then from chapter 12, he said, therefore. What's the meaning of therefore? Therefore means this thing I'm about to tell you now is possible because of what I've told you before. Therefore, my dearly beloved, he said, I beseech you in the name of God, by the message of God, fully and acceptable. Because the visible dimension needs to conform when the body is sacrificed. If the visible dimension is not submitted to the will of the Father, it cannot sustain the capacity to meet the standard of God. He said, do not conform yourself to this world. He said, but be it transformed by the renewal of the mind. That's where the two dimension of the gospel comes in. There is the doctrinal dimension that brings light to the mind. And there is the obedience dimension that brings conformity to the spirit. He said, then you will know. There is a knowledge that you can never have unless you first of all know the truth and you obey the truth. That's why the grace preacher, he tells you about confessing, reciting, but you keep confessing and you don't have the experience because the obedience dimension is not there. Paul said it's when the body is presented as a living sacrifice and the mind is renewed by truth, that is when you will know. The word knowledge there is experience. Many Christians are not walking in experience because they only know truth. They don't obey truth. Alignment is a call unto full obedience. Alignment is a call unto yieldedness to a government that is in the spirit. Alignment is a call unto oneness with God. And these were the truths we began to establish yesterday, that there is an obedience dimension in this call. And I said, the moment that is achieved, something happens to you. I said, the first thing that happens to you is that you journey from the boundary of mortality and you begin to have experiences that are consistent with immortality. That's when sin comes and sin no longer has dominion over you. You will quote it, but you will live in sin until you begin to obey the Holy Spirit, because the ability is imparted when obedience is complete. He said in 2 Corinthians chapter 10, verse 3 to 5, he said, casting down imagination and every high standing thing that opposed itself against the knowledge of the Lord, bringing into captivity all things to the obedience of Christ. That's the first dimension, the mental dimension. And then the second dimension, he said, when your obedience is complete. A lot of people are doing the talking dimension, they are not doing the obedience dimension. He said, when your obedience is complete, then you can avenge all disobedience. Until you come to that point where there is a mental harmony and a spiritual harmony through revelation and obedience, you can never walk like an immortal on the earth. You will be creating impression before people, but in your heart, you will be a slave. That's why a lot of Christians are walking about with secret sins. The reason they are not talking is because they can't find who can help them. But the thing is that help is already with you. The difference is the choices that you choose to make. Alignment is a journey from mortality to immortality. I also said alignment brings us to a place of spiritual fraternity, where we begin to make contact with entities in glory. We make contact with God Himself. We make contact with other high functionaries that have the blueprint to our ordination. You know, Jesus always had fellowship with God, because Jesus said, as Him and the Father are one. So fellowship with God was not a challenge. But for Him to carry out the assignment in Jerusalem, He needed to meet Moses and Elias. And the Bible said they talked with Him about the things He must do in Jerusalem. There are certain things about your destiny. Those set tasks are already with men on earth. You must meet them in the spirit before you walk in those dimensions. It is only by alignment that it is achieved. You can travel. Bishop Oedipo said they can pour a drum of oil on you.
He said, if you don't connect in the spirit, it will translate to nothing. That's why Paul laid hands on Timothy. The presbytery laid hands on Timothy. But Paul said to him, he said, go and find it free. There is something you must do to meet the reality of this dimension in the spirit. If you don't meet it in the spirit, you can never manifest it. You know, most of the fathers, they preach and share the word of God to us, and they don't try to bring their experiences so that we don't see them as gods. They try to show us the word, because they believe that when we know the word of God itself will carry us to the place of obedience. So we don't understand what they went through. So we preach what they preach, but we don't do the obedience dimension. Bishop Oedipo will go and fast for 3 days dry, reading one book of the Bible. And when he's coming down from the mountain, it's only one verse that light will be shed on. For you, you carry the Bible, you cross your leg like this, and then you read it, you say, I'm the righteousness of God in Christ Jesus. I'm the righteousness. Hey, say, glory to God. I'm the righteousness. You are a joker. If Pastor Chris removes his suit, I'm fatter than him. The man is a fasting machine. A fasting. Most of the things they are sharing now, they were experiences they had 20 years ago. The first time Pastor Chris healed a cripple in a crusade was in 1985. He was 24 years old. It's not now you are seeing him on the stage, you think he's an elder, so he has stature. Stature is not a time-based reality. It's a spirit-based reality. 1985. Because they were men of alignment. As a boy, he was going for a meeting. He was ironing his shirt. And iron, he got burnt. And then he removed the iron. He rubbed his hand on the shirt. And what was burnt was restored. So when he meets cancer and he said, be healed, you think he's doing trial and error. They mastered those dimensions in the spirit. They mastered them. He had a cup of water. He fell and broke. He commanded the glass cup. He said, be gathered together. And the broken glass was formed. And then when he speaks to bones, and bones are mended, you think he's playing. They caught those dimensions in the spirit. It's only in our day now that when we are on stage, we want to try something to see whether it will work. What they are doing is it has become their life. They've gained mastery in the spirit. Alignment brings you into spiritual fraternities. I told you my encounters with the man of God. The things I was shown in 2013, up to now, I can't do half of them yet. That was when I realized that even alignment, you have to be helped by the Holy Ghost. That's why I want to show you this morning the precursors of alignment. There is a place for discipline. There's a place for routine life. And every man of God must have it. But there are other life-based infrastructures that God has weaved into your vessel that connects you to the realm of life. Many people are not taught to pay attention to those life-based infrastructures. I didn't know some of these things until I began to meet these men in the spirit. God began to literally carry me to the times when they were growing. You know, the spirit realm is strange. You are standing in somebody's room and then you are in another dimension. You can't make contact with him. You are all on earth, but you are in different time zones. So you can't touch him. You are only brought to learn. So you stand and watch. And then you understand how defective your doctrine is. You know, you can read the writings of Paul and quote him until you meditate on it. And then you see the life of Paul. Then you will know what supports the doctrine. The doctrine rests on the life. So people are not living the life of Paul, but they are talking the language of Paul, and they think they walk in the experience of Paul. I want to show you the precursors of alignment this morning. Because alignment is not just I'm praying, I'm fasting. I was teaching them about the Holy Spirit the other day, and I said the proof that you know the Holy Ghost, it's not in the Bible, it's in your life. If you have known that the Holy Ghost is co-equal with the Father, it's not the Bible that will prove it. It's your reverence for Him that will prove it. If you have known
that the Holy Ghost is omnipresent. It's not the Bible that will prove it. It's your life, your secret life. Because if you are aware that the Holy Ghost is omnipresent, that time you locked the door and you were doing what you were doing, you should know that the Holy Ghost is there. That you are able to think you can do something in the dark is a sign that you have no knowledge about the omnipresent dimension of the Holy Spirit and you have no reverence for the Holy Spirit. You can come to church and lie down and say, Lord, or when you want to pray, you religiously kneel down and close your eyes. That is not reverence. Because the same Holy Ghost you know is omnipresent was there the day you were cheating somebody. The day you were fighting, the day you were insulting, the day you were fornicating, you knew that the Holy Ghost was omnipresent, but the reverence was not there. So the day you have the knowledge of the reverence of the Holy Spirit, it will affect your lifestyle. Because knowledge is transformation. Hallelujah. I want to show you the precursors of alignment. Because the proof that you have begun to gain alignment is that gradually, immortality will begin to seep into your mortal vessel. You will find yourself begin to host the supernatural naturally. It means something is happening to you. You are beginning to travel away from the frailty of mortality and you are beginning to enter into the perfection of immortality. The day alignment becomes established, encounters will become your natural disposition. That's when you'll be on the bike and you'll be hearing the voice of God. On bike. I heard Bishop Oyedepo, he said he was taking his shower and then he heard, arise, get thee down to Lagos and raise for me a people. He was not on 30 days fasting. This time he has grown in alignment so he can carry the realm even to the market. Did you not read about Daniel? When he was younger in the dealings of God, the king had a dream, he called it. Daniel said, give us time. He said, there is the Lord that revealed secrets and he needed to go and pray and fast to receive revelation. But when Daniel grew up, a king had a challenge and they called him and he came and he walked into the palace and he said, he said, your kingdom rose to the heavens and the wings touched the boundaries of the earth. He said, but you have lifted up your heart in pride and you said, I have done this with my hand. He said, therefore your heart shall be taken from you and you shall live among the beasts for 7 years. How did he know? He had grown in alignment so he could carry the supernatural naturally. The king was abusing the chalices, the temple. And then a hand came out and wrote. And Daniel was not there. But at this time, he had grown in alignment to a level where even his fame has spread abroad. Hope you know, when Jesus came from the mountain, the Bible said his fame went abroad. It's not Facebook that makes people popular. It's the angels that blow the shofar. You know, when the four lepers, when God led them to enter into the camp of the Assyrian army, as they were going, their legs were sounding like chariots. How can four people be walking and you are hearing the sound of chariots? The angels were amplifying their footsteps like the footstep of 1,000 army. That's how the angels of God blew the shofar of your fame. You have just one message and everybody is asking for it. It's not because you are on Twitter, you are on Instagram. God raises men, they are carrying it. You say, have you heard this person? Hear this. Take. It becomes their job description. They buy data with their money and they are sending your message everywhere. You don't even know them. They are spiritual realities. When God begins to announce a man, know that alignment has been fulfilled. He said in Luke 1:80, he was in the wilderness. God didn't need to carry him to the palace. He was in the wilderness until the day of his showing forth unto Israel. And he was still in the wilderness. The Bible said the whole of Jerusalem and Judea went to him. Alignment had been fulfilled. Daniel showed up. And he began to narrate everything that happened in the palace while he was in the cave. You know, the king said he wanted to make him one of the princes. And Daniel said, no. Make Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego. He said, me, I will sit at the gates. I will sit at the gate. That's a watcher. He's the one that keeps the integrity of God within the boundaries of that territory. I will sit. So when he showed up, he didn't just come to describe what happened to the king. He came with the judgment of God. He was carrying the judgment of God in his bowels. He came. First of all, they couldn't even read the writing because they don't know the language. Who taught him?
He said, therefore, it is hard for many, many. Take care of us. He said, they are men of wonder. He said to Zacharias, he said, you and the men that sit with you, you are men greatly wondered at. In Isaiah 8:18, he said, Isaiah said, I and the children the Lord has given to me, we are for signs, we are for wonders. When you see a man traveling with the supernatural, don't go and pursue him. Go and read the stories, find out the things he did. Something was reconfigured in his belly. His soul structure was altered. That's when he came to a position he could host it. Because spiritual things are in another dimension. Your shouting and doing like this may not bring it. It's in another dimension. Alignment. If we don't host alignment, if we don't complete the quota of alignment, we will hear about this revival and it will linger until our children come. We will know there's revival. In fact, we will start in the flesh, organizing meetings and shouting and falling down. But revival is not falling down. There are three things that mark revival. One is the spirit of righteousness, where the fear of God becomes the operating system of the citizens. Two is the move of signs and wonders. And three is an invasion of men into the kingdom. There is a force that begins to work beyond normal. It's called an akasho. It compels people, and there will be an exodus of people into the kingdom. The reason it begins with prayer is so that we can be reoriented. We can be reconfigured. Do you know why the prayer power in the East is so strong? It's not because you people pray more, or it's not because you people love prayer. There are princes in this territory that controls the souls of men. This system is weaved into the soul of everybody. You will hardly find three people from the East that either are not given to wardom, or they are not given to the love of money, or they are not given to the spirit of religion. It is part of your tradition in this region. Part and parcel of your tradition. Either he's a religious person, or he's a man of pleasure, or he's a man that loves money. So God is taking you deep in prayer to a place where he will break the cords from your soul. By the time you are coming out, you will discover that you have become a spiritual man that was born through process. They will look at you. The love for money will no longer be there. The love for pleasure will not be there. And the spirit of religion should have been broken. That's when the revival will come to the East. And that's why the prayer power here is so strong. Because God is carrying people into the spirit. You know, before you change the civilization, you will detach from it. John was in the wilderness. If that civilization trained him, they can't correct it. So God is taking you to the womb of the spirit by prayer. It's a detachment process. Most of you have not even begun to receive the instruction of your destiny. You'll find out you pray and groan for 12 hours. But it's as if nothing is happening. It's a detachment. A point will come when your soul will be separated from the influence in this land. That time you are ready to host the glory. But they are precursors. Because these are not things you can do in the flesh. Before you join into the Spirit, the Holy Ghost will carry you there. He's the governor of the realm. And the first precursor for alignment is what we call spiritual hunger. You don't give yourself hunger. Hunger is a natural process that is weaved into a healthy life. The same way, spiritual hunger is a supernatural process that is weaved into a man who is healthy in the spirit. If there is no hunger, alignment can never be achieved. And when I say hunger, I'm not talking about a lack of God. That's not what hunger is. I need to explain this before I go deep. Hunger is not the absence of God. Listen, when you receive Christ, you receive the fullness of God. And Jesus said something. Let me show you a scripture. So that you get me correctly. Look at John chapter 6 verse 33 and 35. I want to explain what hunger is. He said, for the bread of God is he that cometh down from heaven and giveth life unto the world. Verse 35. He said, go directly to verse 35. He said, and Jesus said unto them, I am the bread of life. He that cometh to me shall never hunger. So any man say he's hungry and he doesn't know the meaning, he's trying to say he doesn't have God on his inside. Because if you have received Jesus, you will never hunger. That's what Jesus said. And he said, he that believeth on me shall never thirst. You know what he told the woman at the well? He said, they that believeth in me, he said, they shall out of their bellies, he said, they shall thirst no more, because it shall become a spring of water. Are you there now? So long as your belief in God is still intact, you can't thirst. So long as Jesus is still in you, you can't hunger. So what is hunger? Hunger is the zeal of the Lord. The zeal of the Lord that consumes a man, and it becomes difficult for that man to have enough of God. That's what spiritual hunger is. Spiritual hunger is an activation of the zeal of the Lord. In John chapter 2 verse 17, Jesus, remember, the Bible said in Colossians 2:9, he said it pleased the Father that the fullness of the Godhead should dwell in him bodily. So Jesus could not be hungry for God. But in John 2:17, the Bible said something. He said the zeal of the house of God has consumed him. Is that zeal that pushes him after God and he can't stop? There's a place. It's an organic life. A lot of people think zeal is to come to church and you are doing like this and you are shouting and making. No. If you do it in the flesh, you are deceived. This zeal works on your inside like an economy. It powers you so much that you can't have enough of God. That's why a man, his fellowship, is reading the Bible till 3 a.m. He wakes up by 3. He prays till 12. He's not praying for 12 hours because they say, let's pray for 12 hours. Something is powering him. It's called the zeal of the Lord. And it's God that impacts those bodies. Elijah said in 1 Kings 19 verse 10. He said, I am very jealous for the Lord of God of hosts. The guy comes to a point where he could share in the jealousy of God. That is fire. That is zeal. Many Christians, the Holy Ghost polishes sin in their heart. They deplete it. You deplete what is working within, and then you want to create it without. What you are trying to do is to stir a strange fire. And when you stir a strange fire, the mercy seat that will be your protection will consume you. That's what happened to the sons of Aaron. The fire on the altar was lit by God. They wanted to bring a strange fire before the Lord, and the Bible said they were burned. And God told Aaron, he said, don't weep for them, else you will join them. It takes a lot for God to impart zeal in a man. That's why spiritual men, every time there is a zeal, they shut down and attend to it, because it's a precursor of alignment. There's a place in God you can never enter unless that zeal comes. It's an energy within. If you are hungry, do you start shouting and then you get satisfied? No. Something must enter within. Zeal is an energy within that creates the jealousy of God and the flames of his dimension to burn through you. Many of us don't know how to manage zeal. And that's why alignment is a far cry. He's crying of masturbation every day. When you were on fire, were you masturbating? He's crying of immorality. When you went to that crusade and you caught fire, what happened? Even the desire died. What then happened that the desire is coming back? Because the zeal of the Lord has gone down. You couldn't manage it. So the crisis of our lives that keeps us bound within the confines of mortality is there because we don't know how to manage zeal. For Jesus, he was continually consumed by zeal. What is the zeal of the Lord in your life? I'm not talking about people who have developed their will and they say, let's pray for 12 hours and they are walking like this. Some of them are even creating impressions so that people will see them and know that, no, if it's 12 hours, it's not. How many times do you pray in your bedroom? You come, you want to quote 30 scriptures before you make a sentence. How many times do you sit on the Bible? If you begin to struggle with the things of God, zeal has gone down. Zeal has gone down because zeal is the fuel that powers a believer in the direction of God. You want to walk in alignment perpetually, then you must become a master when it comes to managing zeal. Zeal
is a precursor for alignment.
We are not serving God because we are so disciplined. There is something at work on our inside. If that thing goes down today, you'll be shocked that the man preaching to you now can call on the woman. So what is keeping him standing is not something in the natural. There is something working with him. So every time we labor to keep those internal economies in place. It's just like a car having all the potentials cannot move unless there is fuel. So you must labor to keep the fuel. That's why he said the fire on the altar must not be put out. It's not the responsibility of God. Leviticus 6:12. He said the priest must put wool on it every morning. Even the fat of the rams. It is the responsibility of the believer to manage the zeal of the Lord. Many don't. The day they go for a meeting and hunger comes, that's the time they go back and they go and buy a new set of seasonal movies. It shows where you are in the spirit. You are not wise. Because they can be depleted. Zeal can be depleted. They keep looking for men of God. But what God put in them to bring them to where their ordination will begin to speak, they can manage it. It's called the zeal. How well you do with the zeal of the Lord is what will determine how far you go with God. Alignment is orchestrated by your skill when it comes to managing the zeal. Many don't know how. In the evening, I'll teach you the protocol of alignment. That's when I'll teach you how to manage this dimension. I want to mention them this morning so that when it begins to happen in your life, you will know that, oh, my future depends on this thing. And the Holy Ghost will labor to make sure you nurture it. That's why there will be a season in your life when you don't go for the prayer meetings like a sin. You are restless. You are uncomfortable. The Holy Spirit is teaching you how to manage the zeal. Because if that zeal goes down, even the Holy Ghost can't help you. So he will ensure meticulously that you manage that zeal. A point comes when the Holy Ghost, there is hunger to pray every morning 3 hours or to pray every night. The night you skip, your heart is broken because the Holy Ghost is jealous about that thing you are about to lose. You don't know what it takes for steel to be put in a man. It takes the Lord to light a man. And if a man loses his fire, it is unless he finds mercy, the fire will not be lit again. It's mercy. If God wants to show you mercy, maybe it takes you to another man that is on fire. So the man will help lighten your candle. But Jesus said, if the fire is put out, he will remove the candles. He will remove it. He will remove the candlestick. Because without fire, you are not relevant. That's why he said, you should be what? Fervent in spirit. Serving the Lord. When a demon comes to check you out, it's the fire that you emit that he checks. Jesus said concerning John, he said he was a burning and a shining light. And he said you were willing to stay under his light for a season. So John was not commanding the whole of Israel because he was wise. There was a raging fire that came out of him. When you see 10 million people gathering around the man, it's the fire he's emitting. It's not just the knowledge. Most of them, when you listen to them, you say, what is this? You go to the Hadron case meeting. He teaches for 25 minutes. And then he's talking how God loves you. And then bring all kinds of stories. But what brings 10 million people? You think it's publicity? Papa Iya Adebo was coming to our city. And the whole stadium was packed. Even we didn't know what took us there. We had a meeting that evening. We rounded up the meeting in a hurry. We're running there. You see, if I want to hear his message, I can get this message. What is driving me there? I don't know. It's a compelling force because the man is on fire. You just want to see them. You want to sit under them. When you have 10 people in your fellowship, the problem is not with your publicity strategy. There is no fire on the altar. When the altar begins to burn, it will attract people. You heard the story yesterday.
This thing he's doing was not planned. He went to the stadium, he was praying. He was praying, and one person joined, another person joined. And today, it has become an organized war. It was fire. There are many believers who don't have fire. That's why even in your family, the devil can afford to mess around. Jesus said, the zeal of my Father's house have consumed. You see that habits that you were dead to are resurfacing. Your fire is going down. The day you're on fire, all of those habits, you will be amazed. You will say, is it me? Then you say, I was drinking star. You can't even imagine yourself hold a green bottle and you are coughing. It will look alien because you have traveled into another dimension. You are in another world now. A new culture and a new civilization has indoctrinated your mindset. It is fire that carries men from one point to another. When a man loses his fire, no matter the gift he carries, is no longer relevant with God. Demons can manipulate him. They can bastardize the work of God committed to his hand. The zeal of my Father's heart. That's why we cry every day to go deeper with God. Because God is the one that dwells in the midst of unapproachable fire. So that we can be illuminated. Thank you, Holy Spirit. How many times have you lost your hunger? You left the meeting. It was as if it's fire for fire. That week, every night you are standing and praying. Until your friends came. And then you were gisting for 30 minutes. And the Holy Ghost began to warn you. Say, leave now. And then you gisted for 1 hour. The Holy Ghost said, leave now. That night you wanted to pray. You got tired. And then you went somewhere. They are watching movie. You sat down. Over this actor. The Holy Ghost said, leave now. And then you sat down for 1 hour. They finished part one. They wanted to put part two. The Holy Ghost said, leave now. You watch until part four. Then suddenly, even to go for fellowship becomes a challenge. You have wasted a spiritual deposit. The zeal of the Lord has been wasted. These are the types that frustrate the grace of God. Paul said, I will not frustrate the grace of God. It's called hunger. The second thing the Holy Ghost puts in your spirit in order to bring you to alignment is a desire for God. If you check, you discover there are certain seasons in your life when the word of God was sweet. You are not just hearing the word of God because you want to grow. You love it. You love it. There was a time when prayer was sweet. You were not praying because God wants to do something now. Oh, there's revival. We are the revivalist. No, prayer itself was sweet. When you are there, you enjoy yourself. It's a flavor. Hunger is zeal. Desire is love. Many have lost their love for God. So they pursue the things of the spirit. They don't pursue God. That's why they are not alone. I told you the story of Mary Magdalene yesterday. She went to the sepulchre. She saw the linen. She was not satisfied. The linen cloth proved that Jesus had resurrected. But for her, it was not good enough that she saw the tomb of the resurrected Christ. There are many Christians today who will pay $1,000 to go to Jerusalem. And they want to see where Jesus marched. And then they will stand like this and say, they want to go to the mountain of Horeb. And they will stand like this and say, this is Mount Horeb. They want to go to the sepulchre. But the God that is in their spirit, they have no fellowship with him. There's nothing wrong in going for pilgrimages. It will stir your faith. But there is a place where God is your priority. It's called the first love. Where your motivation is God. Everything you do for God is motivated by God himself. He said to Abraham, I am your shield and your extinct great reward. So beyond Isaac, me. That was why Abraham was able to sacrifice Isaac. Because God taught him something. He had come to a point where Isaac was not as important as God. So he could give up Isaac. He's got that love for God. Mary Magdalene saw the linen cloth.
she was not satisfied. She saw two angels, she was not satisfied until she saw the Lord. Her joy was complete when Jesus said, Mary. And the moment she turned, every time I read that scripture, there's a freshness in my spirit, because I could imagine the joy in the heart of Mary Magdalene. She said, Rabboni. She rushed to hug Jesus. She saw angels, she was not moved. But when she saw Jesus, she lost comportment. And Jesus said, touch me not, for I have not ascended to the Father. That's a man that knows the love of God. A man that has the love of God as an operational economy is a man of perpetual alignment. Because that man is careful to know what pleases the Father. The Bible said Jesus had women that sponsored his ministry. Mary Magdalene was one of them. They can give their resources at any time because they have the love of God. For them, they don't pray because prayer is important. Every time they pray, their motivation is God. They are pursuing fellowship before they pursue anything. They don't study the word of God because there is a sermon they need to preach. They want to find the mind of the Father. They want to have intimacy with the Lord. Koinonia is their motivation. Oneness with God. Many Christians have no love for God. They have love for the things of God. And that's why most times it's the things that come to them as blessings that take them away. The guy is praying 5 hours. You think, oh boy, this boy, they're on fire. His job is praying for. The day they give him the appointment letter in Chevron, you will not see him in prayer meeting again. That's when you tell him, say, you know, he will see you say, come on, ask fellowship. Wow, God is good. Now he says, God is good with his hands in his pocket. Okay, don't worry. One of these days, I will make out time to come. Prayer meeting now is one of these days. So when he was pursuing God, he had no love for God. He was pursuing things. You see him praying. What he's looking for is wife. The day he sees the vision of that woman and he gets her. When he comes for fellowship later, you see, we love you, Lord. You're walking like this in prayer meeting. The sister that kneels down, every time they begin to pray, she's crying. You say, cry. See the kind of body. You even be praying to covet their body. Don't covet anybody's body because you don't know why he's praying. Jesus, do you see the way Sister Anne prays? Oh, Lord, give me the burden of Sister Anne. Maybe she's repenting from immorality. So if you receive the burden. Oh my God. These people have found my sound. It's in the evening that we will do business with this sound. This sound. Oh yeah. When I began to grow in the spirit, I realized that I was wired with musical instruments. I can sleep like this and wake up. If I hear the loud sound, I will enter the spirit. Watch. Find who you are, brother. Don't carry people's body. It's God's body. It's not God's joy and pleasure. So let God furnish the body in you, because your body will lead you to the place of your ordination. Alignment is orchestrated by the love of God. A man that has no love for God can never stay consistent in his walk with God. God said in Colossians chapter 3 verse 1, he said this, if you say you are dead, do you know the point he's trying to make? He's telling you that these things we preach is not a mouth reality. It's an experiential reality. He said if you say you are dead in Christ, that's the question. Paul was the one that propagated the grace doctrine we are preaching today. But Paul knew that grace is a lie unless it's proven in your life. If you say you are dead in Christ and you are risen with him, he says, seek those things that are above. Where is your mind? What is your predominant motivation? He said, of the truth, our life is hid in Christ in God. But if you want to really validate the fact that it's your reality, he said, your affections will be directed towards the things above. What is the substance of your affection? It's a sign whether you are aligned with God or not. Christianity will be a struggle unless you know how to plan to flow the love of God. The
the love of God.
He said the love of God is shed abroad in our hearts. Romans 5 verse 5 is shed abroad.
How do you shed the love of God abroad? You deal with the Holy Ghost. You interact.
I will show you the protocol of alignment. But I'm just showing you the precursors. What are the things that bear true alignment? Where it's no longer a religious thing. Where you don't go to church because it's tradition to go to church. Where you don't pray because it's discipline to pray. There is something you can do to the love of God in your heart. That the more you pray, the more you will charge. The Bible said, the outer man perishes. He said, but the inward man is renewed. When you pray by spiritual economy, something happens. The higher you go, the higher you glow. The stronger you become. The more you do it, the stronger. That's why I said, you dearly beloved, in Jude verse 20, he said, building up yourself upon your most holy faith, praying in the Holy Ghost. So when you pray in the Holy Ghost, you are supposed to become stronger, not weak. There are many who are praying, but when they pray, that's when they collapse. That means they are not working from a spirit-based economy. If you maximize hunger, if you maximize love, and it doesn't die, every spiritual thing you do, you will be invigorated as you do it. Somebody ask me, Spirit, we go small. Say, your schedules are so tight, how do you rest? And then he just looked at the man, and he began to blast him. The guy said, what is he doing? He said, therein is the rest, wherein the righteous will rest. He said, with a stammering long tongues. With a stammer, he began to blast in tongues. So while Smith-Wiggles Lord is exhausted, what he does is that he blasts in tongues. Take a packet. Zididada, Shubra. Did you not read about Jesus? After a crusade, the Bible said he goes to the mountain to pray. What kind of rest? I thought when you leave a crusade, you need to sleep. There is a rest that is in God. We enter through spiritual economies. But men don't take advantage of these things. When the love of God died, that's when they are trying to pray. They want to resurrect love. Were you the one that activated it? Your job is to manage it. It's to steward it. Paul said we have become servants of God. 1 Corinthians 4 verse 1. He said, therefore, we have become the stewards of the mysteries of Christ. You are called to steward spiritual dimensions. You can't create them, but you are made a manager over them. What do you do to the love of God in your spirit? That's what will make you stand in righteousness. Righteousness is not a discipline-based reality. It's a life. In Romans chapter 3 verse 4, he said concerning Jesus that he was raised from the dead by the spirit of holiness. So for Jesus, holiness was a spiritual economy. He was not living above sin because he said, I will not sin again. If that is what you do, is resolution. And go and find out from people who made resolution in 1st of January. Some of them by 12, that same day, they break it. Resolutions don't take men far. Alignment is born from your interaction and dealings and stewarding of the love of God. Are you learning something? You have seen the places where you quench the Spirit of God. In 1 Thessalonians 5:19, it says, quench not the Spirit. Quench not the Spirit. That's Paul talking to the believer. It's possible to quench it, but you don't know what it took. That crusade where you caught fire, they spent over 6 million. The man who came to pray, maybe he fasted for 14 days before he was able to talk to your spirit. He didn't just show up because he knows the Bible. They spoke about men like John Grandios Philly. Before he goes for a crusade, people like Daniel Nash, who is called Father Nash, he will go for 3 weeks and they will pray in tongues, dry fasting. So you come for that crusade, you are crying. You think you are crying because you heard an intelligent message. You don't know what went down. There is a lot of sacrifice that goes on ground for fire to be set in the heart of a man. Never lose your fire. Never lose your love for God. It will cost you everything to keep it, but keep it, because that's what will make you relevant before God. Many quench their fire too easily. It's such a pity that some of us expect things like Facebook that make us lose our fire. Some people come, they send you a message, and then you don't respond. And then they send you a call. Say, I sent you a message, you didn't respond. Are you okay? You sent me a message when you were free. Do you know when I'm free? So you want me to shut down my own schedule because you now, you have done your own work, you want to relax. When you are relaxing, that's when me, I need to pray. Did I send you a message when you were doing what you were doing? You finish your day's business and then you want me to shut down my own business and attend to your appetite. Are you not a joker? If you send the message, leave it. I will respond when I can. That's when I have time for the message. I'm doing other things. I don't barge into your world when you are doing your business. Do I come to your office and say, I want to talk to you? Why are you not responding to me? Okay, you are doing your business. When you are free, if two of us are free coincidentally, beautiful, we will talk. But if we are not free, if it takes me 3 weeks to be free, that's when I have your time. It's a pity that many believers, it's WhatsApp that killed their fire. It's Facebook that killed their fire. They go online, they are scrolling through pictures for 4 hours. And then they contact garbage online. Garbage. And then they don't know why they can't pray. They don't know why they keep masturbating. And then they are pursuing people. Say, hey, man of God, help me, help me. I've been masturbating for 12 years. A believer. You are masturbating. That means you are in a falling state for 12 years. You are dead. Only God can help you. So you can live in one habit. That shows you how cold that person is. Even God himself said, because you are neither hot nor cold, I will spit you out of my mouth. Who told you the man can help you? You have been in one. That means you've never been on fire. For 12 years. Some say 6 years. You have been in immorality for 6 years. It shows you where they are. Some people have no love for God. Don't waste your time. They are just looking for the new person to do a magic on them. If you give them instructions, they will not obey. Because they don't have time for God. They are carried away by their obsessions. And they are slaves in the hand of the prince of this world. Even your gospel will be healed to them. Because they are blinded. The economy of the love of God. Many believers don't have it. And then the third precursor of alignment is what I call seasons and times. I need to round up here. Time is a challenge. Seasons and times. There are certain seasons where God himself decides to bring visitation to people. The Bible said in 1 Chronicles 12:32, he said the sons of Isaac, they have understandings of the times and seasons. The beauty of that scripture is not that they have understanding of times and seasons. The Bible said they knew what Israel ought to do. He said the heads of them were 200, all their brethren were at their commandments. So because they knew the season and they engaged the season, something happened. And authority was invested in them. So they could command others in the ways of God. You can't tell somebody what to do except yourself know and are doing it. So seasons and times sustains the capacity to impart the grace for alignment. Jesus was walking into Jerusalem in Luke chapter 19, verse 43 and 44. And he said he lamented over Jerusalem. He lamented. Why? Because he said they did not know the times of their visitation. Most of you who are praying now, do you think you are praying because you are a prayer warrior? It's a season of revival. So there is an energy in the atmosphere. Everybody that yields himself, that energy overtakes you. That energy overtakes you. I have 2 students here that I disciple on phone. My contact with them have not lasted for up to 2 months. I will not expose them, but they know themselves. One of them could not pray for 30 minutes. If you start praying, you do like this. I said, where are you people? Said they are in Osuka. I said, no. There's a wind of prayer in Osuka. So I told them,
can pray for 1 hour every day for 7 days. Before 7 days was over, he began to pray for three hours. A point came, they blasted in tongues for 7 hours and 9 hours. And then I said, Kai, stop. You are in school. You are not in a cave. If you want prayer to be your lifestyle, when you graduate, I will show you where the Moravians dwell. They could pray in tongues for 9 hours. It's a season. So if you are within the ambience of that region, the energy of that season will come on you. That's the same way the supernatural works in darkness. Most of you were virgins before you came to school. Now, you know the way to all the clubs, and you can't count the men you have slept with. What happened? You entered the spiritual ambience. So the energy of that environment began to regulate your abilities and your choice patterns. It's an energy in the atmosphere. That energy can bind a man, and it can lose a man. He said, when Jesus went to Peter's mother-in-law, he said, there was fever. She was held down with fever. He didn't say a demon. Fever was an energy. So you don't necessarily need a demon to regulate you. Energies regulate humankind. And in seasons where God has a move and a walk, he releases energy into the environment. That's why most of you are praying wide when you are praying. You are in a season. You know the Bible said in Joel chapter 2, verse 28, he said he will pour out of his spirit on all flesh. Because of the spirit that was poured, prophets were born. He said your sons and your daughters, everybody who is a son, everybody who is a daughter, began to prophesy. How? Something was released because of the season. You didn't need to be a prophet to prophesy. You have come into a season. He said in those days I will pour my spirit. He said, even old men will dream dreams, and young men will see vision. So if you are a young man in that time, you will see vision. Not because you have the gift of discernment of spirit. It's a season. The same way, seasons orchestrate dimensions of alignment. So you need to understand the seasons of God on your life. And if you know those seasons, and you yield to those seasons, they will begin to regulate you. That's why when revival begins, you don't care who was a harlot. It doesn't matter. If that harlot comes under the radar, then you will discover that an evangelist has been born. You don't care who is a murderer. All the person needs to do is to come under the radar. If he comes under that radar, then you discover that this one was a prophet. They are seasons. Wise men in the spirit are men that understand the maximization of seasons. So they give themselves to it. If you abuse the seasons of your life, you will never walk in perpetual alignment. There are people that every July they must sin a particular kind of sin. Every December they must sin a particular kind. It's a season. The same way, there are circles in heaven where the windows of heaven are open over you. Those times you will sense unusual hunger for God. Those times you will sense unusual love for God. It's a season. Seasons are also orchestrators of alignment. The fourth thing is ordination. I'm rounding up now, so I'm trying to speed up. So we'll have at least 10 minutes of prayer. The alignment pattern that is needed for a prophet is not the same with an ordinary believer. I told you something about alignment yesterday. I said alignment carries you to energy levels in the spirit where instructions of destiny are. You don't need so much alignment to become a believer. All you need to do is to believe in the immortality of Jesus and confess his lordship. There is a level of alignment that is needed for you to walk in the call. So the ordination of your life will determine the rigidity of the government of the Holy Ghost upon you. So you may be in school and God is troubling you to pray in tongues every day for 6 hours. It's not a doctrine. It's consistent with your ordination. Somebody else may be a minstrel, and what he needs to activate the powers of his ordination is 2 hours of tongues. It's perfect. So don't make people feel you are more spiritual because you are praying more than them. Everybody is attending to a blueprint and a handwriting of his ordination. The most important thing is, don't deceive yourself.
make sure you are attending to the quota of instruction that is coming to you per time. For the disciples, the apostles, the Bible said in Mark chapter 3 verse 14, he said he called them to be with him. Why did they have to be with the Lord? So that he might send them. So there is a level of alignment that these ones will enter if they will be sent. You know, there are many young people today, they wake up and they say, God told me I'm a prophet. That's a calling. You are not called into the world. You are called to be with the Lord. You are only sent into the world. So you could be a prophet, you could be an apostle. Wait in alignment until you are sent. John was a born prophet. The Bible said he was full of the Holy Ghost from his mother's womb. But he waited until the day of his showing forth. There are many people who truncate the protocol of alignment and they want to appear before their world. Some even stand up and they begin to release prophecies for Nigeria. You know what it means to prophesy over a nation? Anything you have authority over must first of all come under your spiritual radar. That you prophesy for people in your fellowship and it comes to pass does not mean you have the capacity to prophesy over a nation. Is that nation under your radar? People are not taught. The Bible said, so long as Samuel lived, he said the hand of God was perpetually against the Philistine. So Samuel had a rank where he could speak over Israel. And when Saul thought it was a joke, and he came to arrest Samuel, the ambience of his anointing covered the whole of Ramah. As long as you enter Ramah, you begin to prophesy. It will show you who the man is in the spirit. It's a product of alignment. Your ordination will determine how deep you will travel with God. Don't be carried away because God told you this. You are a prophet. Wait until God commissions you. Because there are three things that happen when a man is commissioned. The first thing that happens is that God gives him the empowerment for his call. You can be a prophet, but you don't have the empowerment of a prophet. Secondly, God gives him the location and the coverage of his calling. If you step out of that coverage, your head will be on the charger. And the third thing that will happen is that God, go and research it. Although you are looking, you will hear everything. Deep into someone. People are so hungry. When you are talking, you think they are so hungry. But if you were hungry, do you read the Bible? The proof that you are hungry is what you do with God alone. God gives you what? The empowerment for your call. God gives you the coverage, the scope, and the jurisdiction of your call. And then thirdly, God gives you the strategy of your call. If you have not received these three things, you are not yet sent. We don't argue that you are a prophet. But if you are sent, you must have these three things. For Moses, he gave him a rod. That's the empowerment. He gave him the jurisdiction. Deliver my people to the promised land. And he gave him the strategy. It was the plague on Egypt. And the movement of the pillar of cloud and the pillar of fire. Follow that cloud. So long as you follow it, you will enter the promised land. For John, he gave him an empowerment. It was a burning and a shining light. That was the voice that cried in the wilderness. He gave him a strategy, baptism. And he gave him a location, the Jordan River. That was where Jesus met him. A man who has no mandate, commission, or equipping for the call. Who has no location and who has no strategy. He may be called, but he's not been sent. So don't jump out and say, I'm an apostle. And then you start a fellowship. You say, this is apostle, this. I'm going to wait. I received the call at the age of 12. I sat with my mom and the heavens opened. And I saw a visible image of heaven. And a lot of transactions took place. And from that day, God told me I was called. I accepted the call in 2006. I will walk on the road, I will say, me, I will not preach the gospel. Me, I will not. Because every pastor I saw had very big trousers and very white coat, and they were so poor. They are not even inspiring. You see them threatening people. If you don't repent, you will go to hell. So what kind of thing is this? Me. I will never preach.
It was in 2006 I began to enter the Pentecostal setting. I attended a crusade by Evangelist Verona Norman, and I saw a woman moving in
power.
I said, what is this?
Demons crying out, deaf ears opening,
people standing from witch ears. I only thought it was something that happened in television because I was in a remote village in Kasinala. I saw it face to face. That day, the reality of my call came alive. I said, wow. That was when I said, I will preach.
Even at that,
I went to the university. I was a modest and upright person. We schooled in the same school. She was 1 year my senior. On the 300 level, my mom died. I said, no. This thing they call Christianity is a lie. I have not traveled in God with depth where I sustained conviction enough for my calling. At that point, it was enough for me to be a believer. But something attacked my conviction. That was in 2010. I said this thing. Because my mom, there is no night you don't wake up meet her praying. It's as if she doesn't sleep at night. Since I grew up, I have never woken up at night and I didn't hear the voice of my mom. All of you young girls here, that your priority is mascara and foundation. God will never let you marry any man of destiny. Because you will destroy the man and you will destroy his children. Many men that became relevant in this world, it was their mothers that bettered them, including Jesus of Nazareth. It was Mary that groomed Jesus. A woman who is not spiritual is not a candidate for any great man. Better check your convictions and give meaning to your life. I pity most ladies. The beauty of a woman ends at 35, at most 40. See the way I'm looking funny. Wait until I'm 35 or 40 years. When I'm married, my chest will come out. That's when men become handsome. When they become mature. See how tough I am, like a crab. But for the woman, that time you are giving birth to 4 or 5, your tummy comes out. Your face begins to shine. Why do you? It's a woman that should even invest more in the spirit than a man. Because the woman was created a spiritual being. Your womb, for example, is a gate into the supernatural. The woman doesn't know how spiritual she is. So the devil deceives them. They think it's about fashion. There is nothing wrong in being modest, beautiful, and excellent. The Bible said, make garment for Aaron, for beauty and for glory. So God does not abhor beauty and excellence. God loves you when you are beautiful. But that is not what defines your life. That's the point I'm making. When I entered the university after my mom died, I said Christianity is a lie. And I began attending clubs. Began going to one bar with my friends. Just because to satisfy the vacuum in my heart, I was at war with God. The anger, I couldn't deal with it. So I turned to everything that shut down the voice of my calling. And the day I heard of a woman, my friends say, oh boy, this guy don't become man. No worry. They will pay for all your drink. They will pay for the hotel. They will pay the woman. That's to show you how devil plants people around your life to destroy you. These guys will never dash you 1,000. But they are willing to pay for wines. They are willing to pay for the woman. They are willing to pay for the hotel. I carried the lady. As I was about stepping out from the wine bar, a voice came out of the wall. And it came as light. He said, the wages of sin is dead. Suddenly, all my appetite died. It was in the club I repented. Why do you think it happens like that? Because there was a woman on her knees and cried to God for many years. They say, use this man. The same way Samuel was committed to God by her mother. There is no way Samuel can step out of ordination. Those days, I was a scholar. I don't read to enter exam hall. I carry the lecture notes. 8 o'clock exam, I read it by 7. And when I enter the hall, I'm a midfielder. They form squad around me. Everybody copies. I don't read, but I graduated with a 4-point. But I repented in a club because incense had risen to heaven.
He said, this one, this path I'm walking in today, I think I'm not walking in today because I love God. I was gathered onto this path by the prayer of a woman. She said, this one, we serve the Lord. Because God told her, I was a prophet. Those days, growing up, I was a man of anger and rage. I would do certain things, my mom would come and say, I said, they should leave me. What kind of things that? My girl, they wanted to coerce me. She'll be going for Bible studies. She'll carry me in front of the Bible and tell me to read the Bible. She'll be explained. I didn't hate anything like that thing. Sometimes she will lie down and call me and insist I should be reading the Bible for her. I said, what kind of thing is this? People are going to play ball. I will not stay here when it's 4 o'clock. Because I want to go to the field to play ball. I didn't know she was nurturing a calling because of what God told her in the place of intimacy. Why will I be reading the Bible for you? Don't you have eyes? When I'm ready, she say, why now? Yeah, why can't I do that? Sometimes you even buy something for me. Then I'll be eating and reading the Bible. I didn't know that I was installing the infrastructure of my destiny in my spirit. The powers of ordination. When she died, the umbrella over me was lifted. And in 1 year, I became a man of darkness. Until the covenants she had with God was dead. God would be unrighteous if he doesn't attend to the agreements that he entered with that woman. I'm a God man today because my mom wasted her life on the altar. She wasted praying every night so that her seed, she was called a seer, but she couldn't fulfill the call because she married a man that does not fear the Lord. But she told the Lord, he said, this one will serve you. The call I'm fulfilling today was my mother. This one will serve you. Many ladies, they marry men because they have a broad chest. You are sacrificing the powers of your ordination. Every night, she cried so that by mercy, something will rest on me. And in the days when I came to maturity, the powers of ordination began to speak. And God began to change my appetites. Those were the things that carried me, and my steps were guided. And the first time I entered Reverend Chris's meeting, he was talking about the fires of eternity. He said, I saw a white throne. Revelation 20 verse 10. He said, every soul appeared before the white throne. And he said, books were open. And he said, another book was open, which is the book of life. He said, if a man's name is not found, he is cast into the lake of fire. What is this? He read Ezekiel chapter 3 verse 18. He said, if I tell a wicked man, he will die. And you don't tell him, I will demand his blood of your hand. It was as if he was talking to me. I said, what is this? What is this? What is this? Not many days in the place of prayer, God carried me visibly like this. My physical body was carried into the past. And I saw the man of God. And he said, this is how to live your life. Why? Because the powers of ordination began to call. This is how to live. And he brought me back. And he carried me again another time. And I met him. And he gave me his iPad. He said, go and preach the gospel. What? In the flesh, I ran and joined Christ's embassy. I said, this is my father. I didn't know that the protocol of ordination was playing out. When the time came and I understood what he taught, he said, your training is over. Another hunger came again. I separated myself, fasting and praying for 21 days. And a voice came to me. He said, call there now. I got it. And he told me about Apostle Roman. He said, have you heard him? I said, who is Apostle Roman? I'm listening to Pastor Chris Akilome and tell me about Apostle Roman. Who is he? He said, he's in Makodi. I said, nothing is happening in Makodi. He said, go by the library. I stood up on Friday. I said, it's late. Maybe on Saturday. On Saturday, I stood up. It was 6. I said, it's late. And on Sunday, I got up. It was 5:30. I said, I will go there. I couldn't rest. And when I entered, it was in March 2014. And Apostle was only giving a child the way of the Father. And when I stood at the door, he said, this is your father. This is your home. What are you calling? It's called the power of ordination. It was the apostle that told me. He said, you are not a pastor.
He said, if they make you a pastor, they will choke what God has put in you. He said, you are a striker. God has called you to go to the nations of the world. And he will have a meeting. He will say, Mike, go and represent me. How will I represent Apostle Aromi Osa? He was teaching me how to stir the fire of my ordination. They will invite him a JCCL convention. He said, go and represent me. Sir, when I heard Apostle Aromi Osa, it was as if a God was talking. I couldn't write anything. I marveled. Who is this man? Where does he come from? And then that man, in less than 2 years, telling me to represent him. Because God sent you to men that will build you in the days when the powers of your ordination begin to speak. Most of the meetings you go for, you don't go for them because of the publicity. Your steps were being ordered. Saul got up. He was looking for his father's meeting houses. He didn't know that the protocol of ordination had been set in motion. He went past four nations, and when he came to Samuel, Samuel said, is it not because the Lord has anointed you king over his people? The guy thought he was looking for access, but ordinations were manipulating him. Every time hunger comes, ordinations are manipulating you. Every time there is restlessness until you attend the meeting, ordinations are manipulating you. Until you come to that point where you can hear the voice of God. For Moses, it took him 40 years. Wandering in the wilderness until the Bible said in Exodus 3:1, he said he came to the backside of the desert. There are no green pastures in the backside of the desert. What carried him there? It was the power of ordination. And when he reached there, he said he came to Horeb, the mountain of God. And that was the day the scribe that wrote about the life of Moses began to write in heaven. The whole story of Moses before 40 did not exceed one chapter. Because that was not part of what God spoke in heaven. His life began to speak when the embers of ordination was lit on earth, and he saw a burning bush that was burning and was not consumed. And suddenly God told the same man that ran away from Pharaoh, he said, go down to Egypt. I have heard the cry and the affliction of my people. If you heard them, why did you come to me? Ordinations. They are the precursors of true alignment. The day the powers of your ordination begins to speak, you are ready to walk with God. Men who walk with God are not just disciplined. There is something at work on their inside. And you bow your head and pray. And pray. Alignment is the heaviest molecule of life. Men have no understanding, so they live for their appetite. Woe unto me, says Paul, if I preach not the gospel. He said, necessity is laid upon me. Woe unto me, if I preach not the gospel. That's a man that has seen the vistas of heaven. Moses did not leave Egypt just because he felt like. The Bible said he saw him that was invincible. Ordinations were revealed. Ordinations were revealed. Kambaraha Patoa. Pray for an activation, hunger, love for God, and the power of your ordination. And the Holy Ghost. It's a prayer festival.
Ratopa clite ego inekete ketiza harite kosise embretete parute ite kutu elekete kepete kete ikato toga yekete kusese yekete kete suka yeke raso ke roha rahie koroto ekete keklene kia merute ite ita kongra hielia esi rato kra yeku wakata meno baria tetete lege ekato porota niante klenino ebara ato periekla huanto to aia rato baria.
Let's make this prayer a bit effectual. You're going to pray now. Every power that have resisted the manifestation of my ordination, every force, be it Satan, be it distraction, right now, expire, 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 expire,
empire.
Just stretch your hands in my direction. that time of power. Everybody whose heart is open, you are about to enter into something. And so, Father, in the name of Jesus, as we have placed the man by faith, as a mouthpiece, as your mouthpiece in this service, Lord, in the name of Jesus, from my left to my right, from the front to the back, I declare, let the fire rush into them like a mighty rushing wind, and let them receive everything you have for them. Holy Ghost, Holy Ghost, Holy Ghost, I release mantles, I release graces, I release virtue, I release empowerment.
Papa,
in the name of Jesus,
Ekete.
Touch,
Ekete.
Touch,
Itape.
Touch,
Ratosia.
Touch,
Etlete. Likepewa, Atroponia, Zadasude, Efatolia, Bariatoge, Likete, Ekepete,
Ekepetolia,
Iapoa, Araye, Esode, Ebrene, Erite, Zida, Salode, Efatwa, Batublina, Sidiatas, Sidiminas, Sabinidias, Epredinia, Ratlobodos, Evodenia, Yetevenia, Yaligaba, Imbrahodia, Barabude, Edongedata, Lekoko Dubra, Aya, Aya, Obekete, Lekedete, Rekebogo, Asosite, Rute, Epodia, Patua, Clipo, Ekakubikata, Ekekete, Lige, Ailo, Sidinia, Ratoglia, Iata, Cotete, I see
your power. Mantles of power. Come on, fire of God. Selecte, Maretua, mantles of power. Walk, walk, walk in the spirit. Walk in the spirit. Mantles of power. Mantles of power. Touch. When you are there, when When you were there, 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 when you were there,
when you were there.
Take your hand and worship the Lord.
May you